Amen. Please arise as you're able and turn your bodies and spirits to the cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sin, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Exodus, the 16th chapter. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them whether they will follow my instruction or not." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.' And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, what is it? For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, it is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. The word of the Lord.
We will now intone alternate verses of the psalm, which is printed in your bulletin.
So God commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven. Ate the bread of angels. God provided for them food enough.
The Lord caused the east wind to blow in the heavens. They
raining down flesh upon them like dust, and flying birds like the sand of the seas.
Letting them fall in the midst of the camp, and round about the place.
So the people ate and were well filled, for God gave them what they craved.
Second reading is from the book of Ephesians, the fourth chapter. I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling of which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until all of us come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness, in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. The word of the Lord.
To John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us, then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Friends, grace and peace to you from God the Creator and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Two quick things before I jump in. First of all, since it's sermon time, I wanted to share with you that we're so excited that our youth and young adults and leaders who went to New Orleans for the youth gathering are going to be taking the sermon time next Sunday, the 11th, and sharing about their experience. So thanks to all who are preparing that, and we cannot wait to hear about that week away. Woo! Besides flights being delayed and all that kind of stuff. The other thing, too, is that we have our monthly printed newsletter called Grace Highlights. It's available on the usher's desk. Is that correct? Yep. I want to say thanks. Oh, in the narthex on the counter. Thank you. I want to say thanks to Holly for putting that together. Bonnie, our office manager, has been gone now for a few weeks. We're honing in on a replacement for that office manager position, but as we fill in the gaps, folks like Holly have been so helpful. All right, here we go. And I love it when things line up. Lynn and I did not coordinate our messages, but I think we're kind of all in the same place. I got a fever. And the only prescription is more Olympics. Olympic fever is running rampant right now, and I've caught a serious case. Last week I mentioned that there had been a controversy the day before, during the opening ceremonies, and said that I didn't really want to talk about the Olympics without being able to talk about that particular controversy. And a week ago, that was top of mind for all of us, maybe not so much now,
I mean, a week ago seems like a year ago sometimes, but I did want to say just a couple of things about that. For those who didn't see or hear about it, one of the scenes from the opening ceremony depicted the Greek god Dionysus and a Bacchanalian celebration, which are, by tradition, colorful. Let's say that. Yeah, very colorful. And at one point during that scene, it kind of splayed out, and it looked, to those of us who are familiar with Da Vinci's Last Supper, it kind of had the shape and the form of Da Vinci's Last Supper. And immediately social media just exploded with people, Christians, saying how offended they were that the Last Supper would be portrayed in this odd way. There were people dressed in transgender dress, and one guy was painted all blue in his underwear, and like, how could they possibly do this? Now, it may have been a misinterpretation. The head artistic designer for the Paris Olympics issued an apology this week for any offense that was caused, and said that it was not meant to mimic any Christian artwork. So at this point, as far as I can tell, we've got three roads we could go down. Number one, that person's being truthful and it's just a misunderstanding, no harm, no foul. Number two, there were connections to the Last Supper and that really offends you because you don't think God should be mocked. But unfortunately, we follow Jesus who tells us to forgive 7 times 70 times. And so unless you've reached that number, we just forgive and move on. Number three, it did mimic the Last Supper, and it does so in an artistic, albeit out of the box and out there kind of a way, and it becomes a celebration of Christ's love for all people, no exceptions. As far as I can tell, those are our three options, so you choose yours. The real problem with a controversy like that is that it takes the spotlight away from the amazing athletes competing in these games. Whatever you're watching, table tennis or gymnastics or synchronized diving or dressage. Have you seen that? I haven't thought about dressage for 3 years since the last Olympics. Horse dancing. Wow, pretty cool. But it's clear that these athletes have a lot of natural talent. Truly, they have been given gifts, like Lynn said, gifts from God to do the thing that they are doing and representing their country with. Lots of natural talent. Certain body types don't hurt either. Passion for what they're doing. But I have a sneaking feeling, let's say we're watching table tennis. These folks are above and beyond in table tennis. The difference between those competing in the Olympics, and this would be for any of the events, the difference between them and the people who are not competing in the Olympics probably has more to do with the amount of work they have put in. It's not just natural talent, but it's the work that goes in. One of the commercials that was that's running and kind of holding up the Olympics says, it's showing some of our favorite athletes, and it says, "You show us the medals, and we'll show you the early mornings, the late nights, the training through the weekends, the weightlifting, the eating very, very specific diets, etc., etc." I mean, the Olympics take a lot of work across the board. It's hard enough to even host the Olympics. It's thousands of people working for years to coordinate and build. And it usually, it turns out, kind of bankrupts the host city and nation, and in this case, Paris, I hope not, but that's been the trend, and it's just not that sustainable. It is hard to put this all together. And then just imagine spending your whole life preparing and training, and what you get is just a few seconds. It's broadcast to the entire world, and you either stick it or you don't. Obviously, it takes a ton of work to master these crafts, enough to compete in the Olympics. It's a lifelong dream, but a day-to-day slog as people perfect and hone their skills. It is satisfying. It is hopefully fulfilling and rewarding for these folks. And I think that Olympic athletes can act sort of like a model for us. almost like in the old Catholic Church, like the lives of the saints. They are a model for us. This is what it looks like. So for the Olympic athletes, they model for us what happens if you don't give up ever, even working through injuries and family problems and illness and all sorts of things. What happens, what does it look like if you don't give up and you keep putting the work in? It's good to work. Hopefully all of us have some experience with that. It is a blessing to work, something not everyone has. Right here in our own community, some people are unemployed or underemployed, a problem that we need to help to fix. But if you're a Lutheran like me, or not, the word work has become almost like another four-letter word, because of how clear our Lutheran theology is about salvation. We worry about slipping over, as I've talked with other pastors during pericope and plan out sermons, we're always very careful not to slip over into what's called works righteousness. The overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Has anybody heard that song? Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, I couldn't earn it, don't deserve it. Nobody's singing along, I guess maybe. It's the kind of song we sing a lot at LYO and The Gathering, I'm sure, and it's on the radio. So it's, but it does capture the essence of grace fairly well. It is overwhelming, it is never-ending, it is reckless, it leaves the 99 behind to go and find you. So, if that's what grace is, sometimes it naturally leads to question number two. Do we not need to do anything at all? That's a good question. I suppose it depends on what you want. Do you do good work in order to get to heaven someday when you die? Or are you responding to God's amazing love in Christ and simply cannot help yourself but to respond compelled to love and serve God and our neighbors with good work? One of them is not that helpful. The second one is pretty helpful. When we act this way, as though we just can't help but respond to God's amazing grace with lives of service to God and to others, our gratitude has become complete in generosity. So let me be very clear, your Lutheran pastor standing up here, the work that we do, even if it's in the church and even if it's really awesome, does not earn our salvation. Full stop. In the story of the Gospel of John, Jesus has just fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he has what I would expect for Jesus to be a very frustrating, but it's also a very nuanced conversation with the crowd once they finally catch up to him. First of all, they say, why are you here? I almost want him to respond with, I walked here across the water. That's what happened. I walked here. I needed to show my disciples what it's like to put complete faith and trust in God. So this is a neat part of the story. It's a long part of the Gospel of John, the bread of life discourse. And it's amazing how Jesus can nuance the symbol that is the bread and the reality of the bread that fills up the bellies of the crowd, but also as a symbol of God's love, protection, and grace. The other frustrating part, I would think, is when they say, well, what sign are you going to do for us that we might believe? Really? 5 loaves, 2 fish, it's about 5,000. Is this ringing any bells? That was yesterday. So I would imagine he's just a little, but then he says, you're here because your bellies are full, not because you thought it was some kind of a miracle or a sign that points to God. But what really stuck out to me was, this is when he says, this is how you do the work of God, to believe in the one whom he has sent. And maybe even more to the point, I am the bread of life. He who eats of me will never hunger. Those who drink of me shall never thirst. But listen to this. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. All right, if you're paying attention, this is a little bit of a head scratcher. Work, how do we do the work of God? Work implies that something is being earned, right? Work implies that something is being taken for yourself. Work implies that you deserve it. That's how we think of work, right? So Jesus says, do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. Well, then what's left to work on? It's the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God who gives grace and life. So what is there left to work on? Do we have to do anything at all? If we are receiving a free gift of fulfillment, salvation, and love from God in Christ, do we have any work to do? Well, let's think about this. What work is there left to do when you are receiving this amazing free gift? I would say that leaves the work of patience, humility, kindness, the act of paying it forward. These are the kinds of things that we are called to work on as we receive the free gift of grace that comes through Jesus Christ. Is it worth anything? Doing this kind of work, is it really worth anything? I go back to Luther. He didn't get everything right, but one of the things I think he did was when he said, God doesn't need your good work, but your neighbor does. We are called as believers in a world that desperately needs us to act out that faith, act out that belief, and live our lives in service to God, to one another, and to our community. So go ahead and watch the Olympics and tell me whether you believe hard work pays off. Just like those athletes will begin to see the results of putting in that kind of work in a desperate world that needs it so very badly. God doesn't need it, but our neighbors do. At the end of this summer and through the fall, we are going to be working on getting our name out there, inviting others to be a part of what we are doing as we live out our gratitude, which transforms into generosity in lives of service, in saying God is love and God loves all and all are welcome, no exceptions. It starts right here in church today. We come together, we are fed with the bread of life, and then we're sent out into the world to do the work of loving and sharing the good news. We have work to do, church, it's true. We have work to do. First we have received, and now we must give. The work of loving unconditionally and letting this community know that we are here and this is who we are. People steeped, soaked in God's grace and responding to that in lives of love. It is good to work. Work is a blessing. God doesn't need it, but our neighbors do. Thanks be to God. Amen. Today we are gathered together with believers of every time and every place, and so we recite the words of our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Each prayer petition will end with, "Merciful God." Your response is, "Receive our prayer." Calling on the Spirit of wisdom to guide our hearts and minds, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. O wise one, your wisdom has been present in this world since its beginning. Pour out your wisdom into the hearts of the whole church, especially the newly baptized, lay leaders, deacons, pastors, and bishops. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Holy God of all creation, you are the source of all life. Where the sun blazes hard and strong, bring a gentle breeze. In the places experiencing the cold of winter, bring your warmth. Merciful God. Compassionate God, help government leaders of this world unite for peace and justice. Humble all who hold authority, that power is directed toward a more just society. Merciful God. Bread of life from heaven, you feed us. Fill all who hunger with needed nutrition and open our hearts to eliminate hunger in this world. May we see a day when all are fed. May your loving presence be made known to all who are in need, especially Karen, Melba, Ray, Logan, Chuck, Dottie, Brooklyn, Trudy, Lori, Donna, Emma, Damon, Joanne, Valerie, Elizabeth, Susan, Thera, Michelle, Michael, Tom, Kay, Helen, Jim, Jack, Christine, and the family of Marlene Dougherty. Merciful God. O wisdom of truth, help us to understand your will for the church. Be with congregations experiencing transition, redevelopment, and the exciting yet frightening path of newness. May your wisdom be found at every step. Merciful God. Redeeming God, we give you thanks for the lives and witness of your saints now departed. Bring your beloved into eternal glory, opening wide the gates to the heavenly banquet. Merciful God. We lift up these prayers to you, gracious God. Receive them into your holy keeping through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
With
you. Share a sign of peace together. And our offertory hymn today is Let All Things Now Living, number 881, the first verse. That's in your red hymnal. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts,
that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And Jesus also taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Please arise as you're able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please remain standing as you're able for our closing hymn. Number 618. Go in peace, share the good news.
Thanks be to God.